We've got an exciting chat today with a very diverse group of young professionals. I'm just going to let them introduce themselves. Nkanyiso, Sisi, Samuel, in that order, you guys can go for it. I'm Tino, CIOB novice, or Tomorrow's Leaders Cape Town. Work at Robbie Property Group as a project manager in Cape Town. The other guys, you can go for it, and then we can kick it from there.
Okay. I'll go next. Thanks, everybody, and it's a pleasure to be part of this panel this evening. My name is Nkanyiso Mbatha. I'm a project manager for Abland Property Developers in Cape Town. I come from a construction management background, so I see there's a lot of NMMU students there, so I studied my BSc and honours there. Finished in 2013. Feels like yesterday, but it's almost been 10 years. it's great to be here and looking forward to this evening. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sisi. I'm a location management professional for Siemens here in Johannesburg. I'm also Tomorrow's Leader and a chartered member of the CIOB.
Thanks, Sisi.
Hi, everyone. My name is Samuel, and I am the CIOB Tomorrow's Leader for Ghana. I have a background in building technology, comprises construction management and then quantity surveying. But over the years, I've worked more in construction management roles, and currently I work as a construction manager for a local consulting firm.
Awesome. Guys, thanks very much for joining. Quite a diverse panel. And just to everyone who's joined so far, we want to make this a very interactive conversation. We've got quite a diverse group of people, panelists with us here. And it's, you know, as you can see, young professionals in the industry, you've got a lot of students who have joined, which is quite great. But you know, there is no stupid question. Everyone should go for it. Everyone should ask questions, you know, get all the information you can get from the conversation. That's the point of the conversation. So we're in a casual conversation. We want to cover everything, you know, everything you're thinking is a good question because it's going to help you tomorrow. Obviously we've got a framework for the conversation. We've got industry insights and, you know, things we knew when we started and helpful things like, you know, mental health in construction. There's a lot happening. It's a big industry. Samuel can tell you a lot about Ghana. You know, there's a lot of things happening. So, you know, just to set the tone, when we talk about industry insights, guys, it's literally anything that can guide everyone in the conversation. You know, because everyone here is trying to pick a direction. We all are trying to pick a direction as young professionals, but it would be good to hear from you guys, panelists, what you think, just to start off, what you think would be anything that people can venture into the industry or anyway. What do you think the industry is looking like at the moment? Sisi, you can go for it. I see you're rearing, you're ready to go.
Well, thanks, Tino. So I think a great place to start, and I think because so much is happening in the world, there's so many different avenues that are opening. A lot of the times, because we study construction studies or because we study quantity surveying, unless you are part of a multinational company or a big five company, do you see the different avenues and different streams of options of career streams in the industry? So I think perhaps a good place for, I think, the conversation would be to look at, as you mentioned, what other options are there? And I think other than construction, construction management or being a construction manager or being a project manager, there's things that are, or careers that are specialized as facade engineers that come from a construction management background. acoustic engineers that also come from a construction management background, design managers, and that's where we look at like a department that's very focused, or a design department that's very like a focal point for all construction projects, because that's where we get our approvals before anything can go on. So just that option of being a specialist in the design department is, I think, something that we need to see more young junior people branching into and having aspirations of specializing, because we can't all be generalists. I mean, I'm a generalist that can probably make do and manage a team, but I probably wouldn't be able to go to the level of detail required for specific niche projects. And maybe you can add to that from there.
Actually, I want to put it as a question. You mentioned young people going into avenues in the industry. Are you seeing a trend of really young professionals going in and taking up roles which have been traditionally being seen as roles where you need a lot of experience? I mean, I'm posing the question to all three of you. I think anyone can answer. Go for it.
Okay, I'll go. Yeah, I think because of the way the market is at the moment, you know, with COVID, everything's a bit slower than normal. And, you know, I'm talking from this African economic perspective, things are a bit bleak for the construction industry. But that in itself presents a lot of other opportunities. I think that a lot of the youngsters nowadays, you know, when they finish, they get exposed to a lot more, because companies are now looking for young people to take on more, if you want to call it, almost like a senior role and not just sort of like an intern type role or trainee type role. They're looking for individuals who can kind of hit the ground running because of the way the market is. So I think there's a lot of unique opportunities. I mean, I know of someone who's about to finish now their honors and they going into the banking industry. You know, so he's going to be a junior project manager / principal agent for Standard Bank. So I think there's definitely a lot of opportunities in other, what your non-conventional type markets. I mean, even with me, when I was studying at NMU and I finished, I didn't actually know how wide spectrum of career paths one can go. I always thought that I was going to graduate and work for a contractor like WHO and or Group 5 or whatever, you know, be a site manager. And that's all that I knew. And it was because of a lack of exposure. Fortunately, you know, as you grow in your career and you advance, you learn and pick up on certain things. And you also find what you enjoy. Some people enjoy green building. Some people enjoy going to technology, software, you know, things like BIM and things of that nature. Yeah, that's my view.
Awesome. Thanks, Nkanyiso. Samo, anything from a different perspective, anything to add on to that?
Well, I've been thinking, looking at the way the industry is, I know South Africa is more developed in terms of construction management and technology compared to Ghana's industry. And over here, we have a very large informal sector. Most of the construction companies are not well established. Even the very good ones, a bit more informal. So many of the people who graduate are presented with very little opportunity to work in a structured environment. But I think it would be good for people who graduate to grab any opportunity that comes their way, as long as it's going to help them to learn. Because one thing I realized after working for more than 10 years in the industry, it's easier to get a job when you already have one. But when you have no job, nobody wants to work with you. That is what I realized over here. So it doesn't even matter if your experience is very minimal, still people want you. So sometimes we have people asking us to come and do work for them, maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 businesses. Meanwhile, there are so many young people who have just come out of school and are looking for work. And I know they can do that work, but nobody wants to see them in their business because they think when they come, they have to experiment with things and all. So I think we should be ready to grab any opportunity that comes our way. Yeah. I'm sure I'll be able to add more as the conversation goes on.
I think we've lost Tino. Hi, Tino.
He will come back.
Yeah, while he comes back, I just want to add, I think, as you've all mentioned, I think it's important, I definitely agree with you, Samuel, to get involved with whatever opportunity you're given, but to also broaden your horizons in terms of opening up yourself to how big the industry is. Like Kanyisa mentioned, green building technology, Samuel's also been involved in similar different streams. But even though you might be starting off in, let's say, a job to have a job, I definitely think we need to have more of us aspiring to like specialize in specific things. Because we need people who are experts in contracts and contract managers. We need people who are experts in environmental, you know what I mean? We need to have subject matter experts in our industry, because a lot of the things, just as the industry develops, things get watered down. So I think it's very important as we look into how you start to build your career. Start off where you can, make the most of the opportunities you're given, but also open up yourself to finding out what more is available. We don't all have the same career streams. I mean, thing is, I also thought I'd just be a site manager and then that's it. Here I am, you know, doing something totally different. So it's important to broaden our spectrums and to not just stick to what we're told. I think that's important, especially when you're thinking about developing your career.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry guys, you lost me for a second. Okay. So I'm back now. I'm back now. So, yeah, I'm back now. So I'm just going to catch on and just jump in. The other thing I was thinking about now while I was off for like 10 seconds is, and Kanyiso, you mentioned a simple thing about we've been used to hearing, you know, I was going to go work as a site agent, the WBHO, you know, because we had these, I'm talking South African context now. And I think Samuel, you kind of mentioned it in an informal context, but it all comes together. We had these big companies. I mean, the Basil Reeds and the WBHOs and the Murray and Roberts and all of that. They used to absorb all these graduates, you know. And obviously, the avenue was site agent, junior site agent, and so and so forth. That's what we got used to. But now that all those companies are sort of like fragmented and they don't have that big market share and all of that, it's a different market entirely. You know, I think what Sissy said or explained earlier comes into play now, where you've got all these different facets you can fit in. Are you seeing any of that happening in South Africa or in the industry, where you've got these small companies trying to get all these bright young minds in? To get involved. Kanyiso?
Hey, Tina, sorry.
No, cool.
So there are, I think companies in general, as I mentioned earlier, they're looking for a lot more dynamic individuals who come from school. So I think what helps a lot being in varsity is being involved in things like the CIOB, or being involved in green building, or just networking in general. You know, if people in the industry in your area are hosting something, be at the varsity or somewhere close, and it's just a casual get together or presentation of some sort, that's where you meet contacts, and that's where you meet, you know, individuals who are excelling in their careers. Because if I can give advice to youngsters, you can have a great CV and best written CV in the world, but nothing beats word of mouth, or nothing beats someone who's influential vouching for you to say, listen, I've worked with this person, I've met this person, they're a phenomenal human being, they'll be a great asset to your company. And I think with the market being fragmented, as you mentioned, Tina, and the big guys no longer having a huge market share, and the government as well not really pumping money into infrastructure anymore, I think, yeah, people need to be a lot more diverse, and you need to continually diversify. Even when you graduate, you need to continuously look for what's out there in terms of, you know, what short courses, training can I do? Or, you know, what else? And everybody has their niche, things that they like.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. I don't know if you guys, Sissy and Samuel, if you have any comments on that question. If not, we can just jump on to the next.
Yeah. Next. So there's a similar trend here. You have the construction giants, although being few, struggling to maintain their market share. Even to get projects to do is a big challenge for them, because the government here is taking money from overseas, and then, you know, when the money comes with a contractor. So not so much big work for the local giants. Yeah. And recently, the finance minister has said that the young people coming out of school should try to create something for themselves, and people want him dead. But I mean, from my perspective, I don't think it's a wrong thing he said. I've worked on a number of very sophisticated projects, and I see that a lot of the people who work as subcontractors in smart building, that's automation, mechanical, electrical, they are just individuals, sometimes two or three guys who come. But interestingly, these guys do not have a construction background. Many of them have an IT or some form of engineering background, and then they come in. And the kind of things they do are things that people who have a construction background can do and do better. I even see some who come in who have an art background. Those who do the metal work and some of the interior spaces. And all these things are things that people who study, say, architecture can really do, or those who study construction management or QS. They learn a lot of construction technology, but I mean, everybody wants to be QS and project manager, and then they are sitting home. So I would advise the young people listening to us to begin to venture into these areas, especially now that artificial intelligence is becoming the backbone of the digital economy. Yeah. And then we are moving more and more into sustainable buildings, smart buildings. We should begin to look at it. Yeah. I asked one of these guys who does programming for smart building. And then I asked him, if I give you someone to train, how long would it take for the person to learn from you? And he said, if the person is okay here, it will take only 3 months for me to teach them everything here. And then I realized that we are doing ourselves a lot of harm being narrow-minded, because we have enough mental and intellectual capacity to do some of these things for ourselves. Yeah.
Awesome. That's one of the avenues I was looking for, Samuel. And thanks for bringing that up. We'll obviously circle back with that in the questions. I'm just going to go for one. I'm going to extend your conversation for an extra 2 minutes. Maybe Sisi can jump in if you're happy on Kanyiso, so that we can wrap this part of the conversation up and jump on to the next thing. But Samuel, you're mentioning a lot about smart buildings, green buildings. Kanyiso, you mentioned, and you mentioned a lot of emerging trends in the industry. And to a greater extent, what advice would you give to the guys who are still in varsity now? Second year, third year, usually that's where you can start, you know, thinking differently and thinking in a different direction. I don't know how the curriculum is set, but, you know, we're already in the industry. And as far as I can see, I don't know about the three of you, as far as I can see, we are so fast trying to adapt to this story of ESG and green buildings and smart buildings, you know, and smart homes and all of that. You know, what role do you think the students coming in now can play to change all of that and to bring a different facade to the industry? I can tell you, I've tried it, and I've tried to read a lot on on EDGE certifications, and it's a lot of information, I don't want to lie, on top of everything else that you're doing. So do you think that's something that the new built environment students can venture into as a core focus?
Yeah, absolutely. Tino, if I can maybe jump in and answer. You know, these new markets and industries that are developing, you know, with the fast track of technology and, you know, things changing, you know, almost every 6 months, those new positions and roles need to be filled by someone. It needs to be filled by someone who has a basic understanding of the built environment. And those people are the students that are on this panel, it's everybody else who's here in the room. There are a lot of careers that exist now that didn't exist 10 years ago or 20 years ago. For example, a BIM manager didn't exist 15 years ago. It now exists. So there is definitely a lot of opportunity in anything that comes up. And that's why I say it's important for someone to find what they're passionate about and then try and meet people or engage with people. And we're blessed now with Microsoft Teams and technology. You can speak to anyone anywhere in the world at any time, you know. Engage in conversation. That's my advice.
Awesome. Anything else you want to add, guys, to see Samuel? You good, yeah? Awesome. Okay, guys, so just think about industry insights. The one thing I forgot to mention at the beginning is I'll ask a question or two at the end. It's a quiz. And if you get the answer right, based on what the guys were talking about, you win a prize. It's a pretty nice prize, by the way. So I hope you guys are listening and you're just not on for the fun of it. It's a great conversation. So let's keep going. We'll sort of like start circling back after we've covered all the chapters, which is going to be cool. But, you know, I'm going to jump into it straight. And I'm going to say, you know, Samuel, you know, we've been talking a lot. I see a trend here. We've been talking a lot about what the students now should think about for the future, right? But if you were to think back, right, now that you're here, if you were to think back, you know, what things do you wish you knew when you started?
Okay, so you are not a tree. You are a human being. You can move anywhere you want. So some years back, I used to think that, well, because I'm from Ghana and perhaps maybe being an African, if you move to another country outside your home, it means that you are not contributing to the growth of your country, or you don't like your country. And I like being African, and for that matter, being Ghanaian. So I have spent all my life sitting here. But later I got to realize that the younger generation is a more digital generation. And in Africa, there is an analog leadership leading a digital generation. And that is something that is not too good. So it would have been better to have moved into another country, where my potential would have been more enhanced, and then retain, and then try to transfer knowledge to people. I could even have moved to, say, South Africa. And when you are young, it's easy, right after school, no marriage, perhaps no children. That is the time that you can struggle, you can suffer. If you are 50 and you have to think about where your next meal is going to come from, you are in trouble. But if you're 20 and then you've not answered that question, it's not so much of a problem. So maybe I wish I had made that move earlier than now.
Yeah. Thanks for that. And the one thing thanks for that, Samuel. Sorry, I didn't catch you, right? You're done. So the one thing I'm picking up nicely, just to translate it for the guys who are here, the students who are in the conversation, is, Samuel feels, I mean, I'm pretty sure, Samuel, you feel you could move anywhere in the world. So which means your skills were transferable anywhere in the world. Yeah. And you felt confident to be anywhere. Yeah. And I think that's something which you guys can just also, you know, apply your minds to, you know. Africa is developing, things are happening. But don't always discount your skills. You've got very useful skills. So it's something to think about in the greater scheme of things. Sisi, I know you're rearing to have something to add on that. You obviously you obviously came in the industry. You're like, you know, I want to change a lot of things. Women in construction, everything is, you know.
So I think for me, two things I wish I knew starting out. I think I wish I knew back then that the rooms I found myself in were rooms I was supposed to be in. Because I always felt like, oh, I'm just going to be that girl on site who's just going to like do stuff and like shine. And like, I don't need to be in this room having this conversation or being exposed to like this level of the project or whatever. So I wish I never had the imposter syndrome as much as I did back then. So just to like take opportunities that you're given, take the invitations to meetings that you're given and attending them and preparing and just being like a full-on professional, even at a junior level. So I wish I knew that I could be a professional starting out. And then I think the other thing would be, I wish I knew that time management didn't only matter on site, but also like in my life, because especially in contracting, my contracting background, we're so on top of project plans and project schedules, but we're so unaware of what's happening in our own lives. And we just give ourselves to the time of the project. And then we watch our young age just pass us by. And then it's 5 years later and you're just like, I just moved one. I only got promoted once or whatever. But it's because I wasn't like diversifying myself as a professional. I wasn't being involved in things that interested me and wasn't managing my time or in my life, you know? So yeah. It doesn't really matter on projects. It matters in your life as well. So I think those are the two things I wish I knew better starting out.
Yeah, and if I can add as well, Tina, if you don't mind, I think the things I wish I knew when I started working fresh out of school was the importance of having a mentor. So like mentorship, having someone to look up to ask questions, what should I do in this situation? You know, if you get stuck in your career, maybe you're not happy where you're working or whatever, it's always important to just have someone who you look up to and who you trust to give you guidance. And I think also just think the importance of maintaining relationships and never burning any bridges. You know, as much as construction's a huge industry, it's also very small by the same time. Everybody knows everyone. And it's important to maintain good relationships, even, you know, with people you're not working closely with anymore. You just never know when you're going to need someone.
And when you say the industry is too small, I know the guys in the conversations won't believe you that the industry is too small, but I think people are looking in the right place. Do you think people are not looking in the right places when they actually look for employment or any of it?
Oh, you mean like with reference to the industry being too small?
Yeah.
I mean, as I said, word of mouth it counts a lot. Yes, you can go through recruitment agencies and, you know, apply online, but, you know, those kind of scenarios, your CV is just another one out of the 10,000 that are piled up, and by luck, whoever's making the decision will come across it and may employ you. Versus if, you know, if they meet you in not so common ways. And that's why, as I said, it's important to maintain relations, because you don't know the people who you used to work with or associated with, even if it's a consultant on a project or just someone, and you had a good relationship with that person, you guys work well, and then that person diversifies and goes into someone else, something else. And they think, yes, you know, Tina might be a good person for this. I actually want him involved here. And you know, that's how you get a hold of the most unique opportunities.
Yeah.
Yes, you might get lucky the conventional way, applying online and going through an agent, but yeah, I mean, the odds are much lower than what's
leaving. Yeah. I mean, I'll give you a typical scenario. Let's say I'm a third year student, or let's say I'm a second year student, and I don't know anyone in the industry at all. How do I go about
it?
I'll get.
So you have to put yourself out there. Hey? Yeah, but there's no other way, unfortunately. So obviously speak to your professors at the varsity. They know a lot of people in the industry. So if you have good relationships with your professors or your lecturers, I think they usually are good points of reference. And then also go to companies, you know, wherever, walk in the front door and say, look, I'm willing to work for free, even if it's just to gain some experience, just to get some hours to your name. And, you know, you might not know what may come of that, you know, while you look for something permanent. And yeah, don't look down on something or someone. You know, if you're stuck at home unemployed and, you know, a small bodybuilder comes and says, no, I'm just looking for a senior foreman or something, you know, take the opportunity, because you don't know where that may lead and what doors that may open. But yeah, to me, it's important to network and to put yourself out there. That's how I'd go about it.
Yeah. Samuel, you had something to add. Thanks, Kanyiso. That was some really good advice.
Yeah, so I can identify with the suggestions he gave there. I actually started that way. Right after school, I worked as a teaching assistant, but I wanted to keep myself active also with practical stuff in the industry. So part of what I did was to team up with my friends and then print brochures, telling people what we can do. And then 1 year later, we started getting work. It's interesting that even now that I work as a construction manager, sometimes you need someone to provide a service for you on a project. And you in the heat of the moment, nobody comes to mind. And you call this person and they tell you, my hands are tied. You call this other person and then you just don't know. And you have to call your friends elsewhere to ask them to find someone for you. But if, for example, I had a list of people that I knew could do the work readily, I would just look through the list and start going through their numbers one by one and then try to invite them. So that works really well. Also, if you are in school and then you happen to be someone who is outgoing, it's a big plus for you. Now, some of the people that you sit in the classroom with right after school will hold very big positions because they know people in big places. If you were close to that person, perhaps helping them with their thesis or their some other schoolwork, they will call you when they need someone to help. You know, it's strange. I don't know if it's the same in South Africa, but when we're in school, the guys who we tend to see as the lazy guys, maybe because they know nobody wants them, they are the first school to get work right after school, because then they have all their connections sorted.
Yeah.
And then when they get work, they will need help. Who will they call? The social connections. 10 years later, those of your colleagues, if you yourself have not gotten there, those of your colleagues who are well established would be also in big, big places.
Mm.
If you have maintained the contact, they would have you in mind and always call you. So we need to build a very strong social network. Keep it active. If there's a WhatsApp group for your class, don't just sit there and then allow the rest to talk. Talk when issues are there, discuss it. It will lead you somewhere that you don't even expect.
Yeah, 100%. Sisi, do you have anything to add, or were we happy? Oh, you're muted.
It has to happen at least once, right? I think these kinds of engagements are great opportunities as well, because I think once you know people's names, you can connect with them on LinkedIn. That's creating your network. That's growing your network. Getting involved in webinars. There's a lot of industry webinars held by specialists where you can meet people who are specialists. Maybe they speak to topics that you're interested in, and that's a way to connect with those companies, connect with those people. So I definitely think such, like, again, using the world is becoming very network-based. So engaging and finding out what people are doing in the industry and being there, showing up, and just attending. I got my first job at a construction seminar. They were looking for students, right place, right time. So network, get involved and be where the industry is active is also a good place, especially if you're not somebody who's, I'm not that person on WhatsApp group. So I definitely prefer like interactive interactions. And I think find what works for you. But you must expose yourself to the people in the industry some way or other.
Yeah. And do you think the connection between Nkanyiso is there? Either of you can answer the question. The connection between mentors and mentees. Do you think it has to be the mentor finding the mentee all the time, or is it the other way around? How would you navigate that story?
I see it as we all have people we admire, right? And we all have our, for lack of a better term, dreams or your fantasy of what you want to do. And, you know, everybody looks up to someone, and ideally you want to look up to someone who's progressed very far in their life and, you know, has accomplished a lot of the things that you personally want to accomplish. So I think it's up to the mentee to find the mentor. And also in life in general, I mean, this just goes generally for anything. No one in life is going to do you favors. You know, no one's going to come to you and spoon feed you things and you know, and baby you. It's a big, cruel world out there. You have to do things for yourself. So I think in most cases, yes, you are fortunate enough if somebody senior comes to you and says, oh, hey, you know, I like your energy. You seem like a cool person. I want to mentor you. But most of the time it's the other way around. It's people who go to people and say, look, can you help me with this? Or look, I look up to you in this way, or I admire your work that you've done. Can you teach me how I can improve? And that's how it starts.
And actually on that, just to maybe a comment, is that when the call them young professionals or the professionals in the industry are going with their day to day, it really does get busy. And sometimes it's actually, it's welcoming, or it's welcomed actually, that you get young people who actually want to get involved and young people who actually ask questions, because, you know, sometimes it distracts you from your day to day and you actually feel like you want to give back. So there's no, you know, as a mentee, there's no limit to how many times you can try and get in contact, or how many times you can try and find a mentor, someone to guide you with a certain thing. And I think people appreciate it in the industry. It's a very small industry. It's a very small community. And I think people like communicating between each other, you know. And on that note, Nkanyiso, do you think this is a hectic industry?
Yes. No, it's very, as you know, you're only as good as your last project. So that's how you are judged sometimes. And it's very rewarding when a project goes well and, you know, you drive past a building and you say, yo, I was involved in that project. And, you know, you appreciate the sweat and, you know, the hard times and the good times as well. You know, it's not all doom and gloom. But I think it is a very hard industry. You need to have a thick skin. Now, speaking from my personal experience, you know, especially when you're young, people who've been in the game a long time, you know, you get very stubborn, you know, foreman, whatever. Yeah, I've been doing it this way for 30 years. You know, who are you to tell me as a graduate coming fresh out of school that I've done this wrong? So you guys can relate. And people will test you. And, you know, project management, as well, what I've learned is that it's about managing personalities, you know, knowing how to get the best out of people. You know, you get people where you don't have to be firm, or you don't have to shout or push them. They'll do stuff for you. Then you get people who are opposite. They're only, you know, good at reacting when you put them under pressure, you put them on the spot. But I always believe in doing it respectfully and always treating people with respect.
Yeah.
And the industry is already hard enough as it is, with the tight deadlines and the small margins for error and the small profit lines. I think everybody's already, their stress levels are quite high on any project. So you want to make it as pleasant as possible, because we all want the same thing. We all want the project to be a success. We all want to make money. Yeah. And yeah, we all want to enjoy doing it, you know, while it happens. And I think it's always important. I think CC spoke on it, finding that balance. You know, you don't want to fall into the trap where you had work 6 a.m. and leaving at 8, 9 o'clock at night every day, because you will burn out. I'm sure we've all been in similar situations when the deadlines are tight and you just finished. I think you must remember that the work never stops. You'll get to that point where you can work 24 hours a day, you still won't finish everything that you could have done. So it's always important, focus on the things that are going to get you fired. You know, if you don't do something, and you will get fired for that, rather focus on that and then obviously just prioritizing time management. It's not something we taught very well all the time. And everybody has their own rhythm or system of doing things. So it's important to focus on those key areas. But yes, to answer the question, it is a tough industry, but also very rewarding as well.
Yeah. Look, I'm gonna get to Sisi. I know you have a comment about the industry and how it's hectic and all of that. But I wanted to read Jessica's. I know many people don't read comments, but I wanted to read what Jessica said. I can see the questions in the comment section. The CIOB does connect members with mentors, and you guys should note that. So. Please do register as a student. Start from where you can at the moment, and you do get that help with the CIOB. That's why we get these platforms, and that's why we do what we're doing now, because you know we're trying to give back and to just develop everyone else coming up. You can see everyone here on the panel is a tomorrow's leader, so, and you can see they've got valuable insights and experience, and it all comes from these platforms. So please do sign up, do join, and that's going to be an added advantage to you as a member. Sisi, coming back to the question of the industry, how taxing it is and how hectic things can get, how has it been?
Yeah, no, I think definitely, I think we've all speak to the same thing. It's a very hectic industry, and I do agree you have to have a tough skin, but also just to remember not to let things change you. A lot of the times we want to morph into becoming things that we can't keep up with, and that's not sustainable. I think remembering to stay authentic, but also doing what needs to get done and not letting people change you. Yeah. I think that's something that we're not told often enough. Toughen up. Yeah, you can toughen up, but also there's certain things that you don't have to deal with. Just staying present in and reminding yourself what you're here to do, and making sure you're doing that, and respect is definitely something the industry needs more of. It's a tough industry, but I'm just the thing I tell anybody is just to don't let it change you, whatever it is, because we need more of a diverse type of person. I think we all think of like this sight language speaking person and tough, no life, you know, but the industry needs more of that. So it's accommodating to a lot more people. I mean, not everybody aspires to be a sight, you know? Yeah. So yeah, the industry is tough. But yeah, we need more people to stay true to who they are.
Yeah. And the thing is, you know, we're always chasing time. We're always chasing, we're always trying to minimize costs. We're always trying to, you know, make sure that, you know, there's deadlines. It's always working to a certain deadline, to a certain budget, to a certain this. And I mean, do you think that results in a lot of, you know, mental health issues in the industry, or how would people approach that if that's the case, in a sense? Because it does get hectic and things do get very challenging, but how do you navigate that particular? Do you have any experiences or any perspectives on that?
Yeah, I think it's been what has often happened with also my peers is that we become so engrossed in projects, because projects are so fast moving and so dynamic. You kind of have to get stuck in, otherwise you're afraid you're going to get left behind. And then we idolize projects and it becomes our life. And then we kind of forget about the natural person or the natural state or the life outside of this project. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the times that's what causes the burnout. That's what breaks and burns bridges. And that's what tarnishes relationships and essentially affecting one's mental health. So this culture that we've built around how to meet deadlines, I think, sometimes gets to people, especially if you're just trying to learn and trying to get involved, and you don't really have you're not steady and have your feet on the ground, or you don't have a mentor to remind you of what's important. You definitely become one track minded, and it's about the project, it's about finishing. I have to pour this pour on Saturday morning, and then it goes, oh, I have to finish this, I have to strip it on Sunday, then your week is gone, you know. So I've definitely experienced where I've just idolized, and it's project after project after project, and then you're like, I've become a zombie. Like, what's happening? How do I get out of this? How do I normalize that? You know. Yeah. So it's just finding that, or getting out of that loop, you know. So yeah.
And have you? Do you have any basic tips or tricks? It can be anything on how you've managed to navigate that.
So definitely one thing you mentioned about a mentor, I think mentors or colleagues in different spaces or different careers, that'll definitely balance you out and remind you about what's important in life, just making sure you create those relationships. And I think boundaries are very important. If you can work a certain number of hours, at least to have regulation in South Africa, but to make sure that you don't exceed it. Like, you can't be going 12 hours every day for 7 weeks. You know, you have to have a boundary of, no, I'm going home now, or making sure you manage your time so that you can go home and be able to have, like, transparent conversations with your manager, you know. Making sure you express your expectations is also something that's very important, so you don't feel guilty about leaving on time sometimes. So I think just that transparency and just being real with yourself about what you want to achieve and expressing that me has kind of something I'm still trying to do better now in my new role. Just to be real with what you want to achieve, not to impress other people, but to just remember you're building your own career, not to please others, but just to develop yourself. Transparency for me, and that relational community definitely is something that helps.
Plus, I also know for a fact that when you're in the industry for 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, whatever amount of time you're in, you know, you can always get answers to certain things from people who've been in the industry for 15 years. Do you know what I mean? Because usually what we all get caught up in is the fact that you're busy thinking about this little silo you're in, and your mind always runs in that little silo because you've got all these deadlines and all these things you need to achieve. But, you know, when you don't have blinkers and you look out and you share those issues with all these people with experience, they'll be like, you know, I did that 10 years ago. And, you know, how I navigated, I did this way. You know, and that's where I know it's not the focus of this conversation, but I know we've had mentorship chats on their own in these platforms, but mentorship plays a massive role in all the aspects that we've discussed.
Yeah,
because that's where you get some answers to things that don't seem like they've answers. You need to get it from someone's perspective.
Yeah,
it's not in a book.
Definitely.
In a sense, Samuel, do you have a comment on that, on the industry, mental health, how to deal with all the pressure? Samuel. Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay, you're muted.
I missed the last part. Can you repeat it for me?
Okay. Now we're just reiterating the fact that, you know, people who are already in the industry, who have experience and have gone through it, and you know, gone through the motions, they know more than we know as young professionals. And we get so caught up in the swing of things every day, you know, to a certain point where you start stressing about things, you know, you start losing track of things, you start getting overwhelmed. But, you know, when you have a conversation with a mentor, someone who's experienced it, it just gets better because you get a perspective of someone who has experience on something, you know, and try and see that at the end of the world. So I don't know if you have been involved in such a situation, or you've given advice and how you navigate that.
Oh, yeah, that's true. So it's something I have actually paid a lot of attention to, and it's called role supplementation, used a lot in other areas aside construction. And they got that insight from, you know, in some countries when someone is a new mother, they have their first baby, they will likely go live with their mother so that she can take them through the steps, takes them off a lot of stress. And they've actually started using it in some industries, manufacturing and other places. So it's something that I have tried myself. Sometimes you have a Herculean task to deal with. And you know, when you enter into the industry at first and you're trying to impress people, it gets to a point where you begin to deceive yourself into thinking that the whole industry or the whole organization revolves around you. If you don't work hard, it's going to come down. It's not going to come down. Yeah. When you speak to, you know, you have seniors at the workplace, after work, they go and sit somewhere and then they go and have a drink, or they go and eat, they go and watch UEFA Champions League. And then you right after work, you go back home and sit behind your laptop, trying to finish your drawings, your project program, thinking that the next day won't come if you don't finish working. How is it that they are able to go? When you get closer to these people, they begin to tell you some of the tricks that they have used that helps. More often than not, when we take things easy, we begin to understand that things can be done. Not to mean that we should be lazy, but when we take things easy, we begin to understand that things can be done in a more calm way. Of course, many organizations have a very high pressure environment, but if you have shown yourself to be very diligent in your work, and then you work hard, and then you apply your talent, you realize that it's very difficult for the organization to easily replace you. And at that point, you should begin to try to get some time for yourself also. Yeah. And I would also emphasize the importance of trying to have some good sleep, just rest. Now, you mentioned mental health in passing. Interestingly, in our part of the world, a lot of young people suffer from poor sleep. Now, that is a mental health problem, according to WHO. They don't sleep well. And sometimes, even when going to bed, they're afraid that the next day will come too quickly, so they won't enjoy their sleep because they have to be in traffic and go to work and all that. But we need to make some time for ourselves, at least maybe 2 or 3 times in a week, get a full night's sleep. And that really helps. It makes us very calm.
100%. I totally agree. Since that's our last sort of like section we wanted to discuss. I think we're running out of time. Correct me if I'm wrong, guys. But I wanted definitely for you guys to address one of the things. We've kind of discussed a little bit about it, but we went on a little bit of a different direction. But I see one question which I wanted to go back to, and it relates to industry insights. And the guys are asking, I think it was Owetu, was asking, where you see the industry in 5 years, the SA industry in 5 years. You guys have a strong insight on the SA industry. I mean, well, what do you think is going to be happening in the next 5 years? Yeah, anyone can jump in.
Anyone can answer. Yo, it's always a tricky question because, you know, 5 years ago, nobody would have known COVID existed, and nobody would have imagined the impact and how the world would have changed. The South African industry in 5 years, well, I guess knowing what we know now, I like to be optimistic. I think the industry will recover. I think the economy will recover. I think there's a lot of young guys out there who are trying new things and reinventing the wheel, and you know, I think innovation and technology, you know, if we as a South African market want to compete and remain, you know, sustainable, we have to make use of new ways of doing things. And I think a lot of people and organizations now are starting to appreciate that a lot more. I mean, I was very surprised. I mean, we're busy negotiating now with WHO on one of our projects, and they now have a full-time BIM person, you know, in the WHO group. And I was very like shocked to find out, you know, a contracting company now has like a BIM person who they've employed to do BIM for them. So I think the industry is changing for the better, slowly but surely. And I think in 5 years' time, where I'd like the industry to be is I'd like South Africa to stop doing things the same old way. You know, when it comes to sustainable, even if it's housing, you know, we have a housing shortage here. We're still building RGP houses, you know, the old school way, bricks and mortar. I mean, there's so much out there, you know, prefabrication and, you know, things like that, that there's just so many opportunities, and it requires a lot of young people like us, people on this phone call, you know, to take that opportunity and to make it happen. It doesn't happen overnight. It takes time. But that's where I'd like to see the industry in 5 years.
Yeah. I was about to think that I'm not a very good project manager. I'm going over time, but then I realized we started at 10 past, so I've got 9 minutes to answer questions and do my quiz.
Yeah, you got a delay claim that was approved. So you still
the guys have to understand. But on that, guys, feel free to post the questions in the chat group. I'm going to address all of them. I just saw one question now, which you just discussed. And I'm just going to give you 2 minutes to think on what we've just discussed, and I'll ask about two or three questions. If you get one of them right, then, or if you get one of them right first, then you win a nice parcel. I think the other questions in the chat group have been addressed by the guys in the chat. So go in the chat group. There is a lot of information being shared there by Jessica and Tando. The guys are just giving a lot of information on the CIOB and how we can connect with people, how we can go around and just have all these conversations we're having all the time. Follow the conversations. There's great information being shared on here, which is actually quite brilliant. But just to wrap up the discussion, just in a short way, between the three of you, you guys, anyone can start, Sisi can start. What do you think could be the game changer if you're a student? I know this is impromptu, but you know, this is where you guys come in with the experience. If you're a student, what do you think would be a game changer when you are trying to get your feet in the industry, to get your foot in the industry and get going?
I think being informed. I think a lot of the times I've had juniors in my team as well, and the ones that have always been stars to kind of grow in a business have been the ones who've been well informed about the types of projects that, first of all, that they're involved in, the type of projects that the business is trying to go into, and also kind of knowing how the industry in the macro is moving. So understanding that we're moving, if this business is moving into AI, if this business is moving into technology, or if this business is moving to green building. So I think being informed is probably the most important thing. And goes back to what we were saying about if you're not like looking down on opportunities, if you're somebody looking for a job, get involved in short courses. There's so much free information now, like quality information. Expose yourself to what's happening in the industry. And that sets you apart, because if I was your manager and I see you're on top of things, I'm going to give you more opportunities, because I can trust that you're somebody who's proactive, you are studious, and I want to work with people like you, you know? So definitely a game changer if it's being informed. And I think even at any stage of your career, just know where you're going, know where they want to go, and know what you need to know, and know it well. So that's definitely my two cents for a student.
Yeah, pretty comprehensive. Samuel?
Yeah, so I'd also agree with what Sisi just said, be informed. And you get information when you join a professional association like the CIOB. I joined the CIOB as a student member in 2007. And at the time we used to have, I think it was a quarterly magazine called Icon. And the issues being talked about frequently were sustainability, safety, and then the hot topics today, the 2030 milestones. Supposing I had taken them seriously and perhaps had gone into developing my IT skills, I would probably have been in high demand today. because approaching 2030, those are the issues that the whole world is focusing on. So you get information when you join a professional association. If anyone is here who has not yet registered to become a member, and it's free to become a student member, at no cost at all, you will get information. Now everything is online, and then you can, I don't know where those journals are, but now you have everything online. You can keep them with you for the next 1,000 years, and you have a lot of information that you can use. Even now, they are talking about things that happen in 2050.
Yeah.
All other things being equal, many of the young people today will be alive in 2050. What will you be doing by then? Would you want to think, oh, I had this back in 2021. I should have done something about it.
Okay, maybe I'll also then add to that question on what the game changer is for students. I think every company appreciates people who, I think they've mentioned this already, takes the initiative. You know, when you're given a task, you know, do it diligently. If you're stuck, ask questions. I think some people, I'm just talking general, you know, if something's very hard or too complicated, they kind of like just put it aside and not really address it until they actually really have to look at it. So try and avoid that. And also, yeah, if you're struggling with things, you know, you have something that's bothering you, don't be scared to talk about it to the right people. And, you know, there's always going to be problems on projects, problems on sites. You know, building is not a perfect science. And don't ever fall into that trap of holding that burden onto you to say, oh, you know, I should have done this better, or I should have done that better. Hindsight's always a perfect science, so it's always easy to look back. When a project is done, I shouldn't have done this, shouldn't have done that. Yeah, and also, again, finding the balance, you know, resting when you need to, and yeah, just not dwelling on things too much, and having a hobby is very critical. We appreciate, obviously, people who work hard and are smart, but we enjoy keeping students who have a good personality and you get along with them. Because work is about that. It's yes, you want someone who gets the job done, but you don't want to be stuck in an office with someone who's miserable all the time.
Thanks, Kanyiso. Thanks, guys, 100%. Now, actually, I saw a hand up here, and I thought I was neglecting the guys in the conversation, and now the hands are gone, so I don't know who wanted to ask a question. Sorry, guys. But do we have any questions from the floor? Anyone wanting to know anything from the guys? It'll be good to get some information now. Teddy, I'm pretty sure you have a question.
I was just about to say that the hand was from Kumo, because I was also noting down if there were hands up, just so that we don't forget.
Yeah.
So Kumo, if you'd like to go ahead, please unmute yourself. And also, just to mention, these are our Sub-Saharan Africa Tomorrow's Leaders Champions. And this is actually a great opportunity to ask questions. I don't think we'll have this kind of opportunity anytime this year. So please go ahead and ask questions or seek clarity. It's really a great opportunity for us as students.
Hi, Dando, and hi, everyone else. My hand was a mistake. I'm sorry. That's why it went down so quickly. It was a mistake, but it was great hearing from you guys. Thank you so much for your time.
Awesome. At least you got to add your thanks to the guys. You can, you can think up a question while you're at it, so that's fine. There's another hand. You can unmute yourself and go for it. I think you're the only one at the moment. Who is it? Now the hand is gone again. Can't pick it up. Oh, it's Moripiwa. Yeah, go for it.
Oh, yes. I'm waiting for the quiz.
You've been listening. That's a good thing.
Yeah, I wrote notes, eh? From everyone.
That's a good thing.
Honestly, yeah. I'm also just waiting for that.
Yeah, brilliant. No, you guys don't want to ask questions, so we're going to jump onto the quiz now. So I don't see anyone wanting to ask any questions. Teddy, do you have any other remarks or anything to say there?
Yeah, just to quickly say, we will be publishing newsletters quarterly, and I think I'd like, if there's any students or CIOB students that maybe have received distinctions, we'd definitely like to add or celebrate you on our newsletters. I think we've got about 700 or 800 subscribers internationally. So I think it's a great opportunity. So if you've got any success stories you'd like us to publish, or if you've got any upcoming events you'd like CIOB community to know about, please reach out to myself or Jessica. That's pretty much it. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Thanks, eh? Thanks a lot. Okay, I'm just going to pop two questions at the moment. And I think you guys can just pop your answers in the chat group. I think that's the easiest way of doing it. So, Nkanyiso mentioned a platform where, let's start with Sisi's part of the conversation. Sisi mentioned a platform where you can engage and get more information. What is that platform? It should be pretty straightforward because, I won't give you a hint because it's looking at you in the face. Okay, so I don't know whose hand was up first here. Teddy, were you taking a look at this?
It was Kumo.
Yeah. I noticed Kumo.
Hi.
Had her hand up first.
It would be so funny if I get this wrong. CIOB.
Oh, I just spoke about it 2 weeks ago.
On LinkedIn.
Did you say? Sorry, I didn't get you there.
It's either CIOB or LinkedIn. I'm not sure. I feel like I'm wrong.
I think you kind of shot at everything there, but it was LinkedIn, one of the platforms that Sisi mentioned. So nice one for listening there. I guess you were listening when she was talking. I don't know if you were listening when Nkanyiso was talking. So I hope you can answer this one for us as a bonus. Nkanyiso did mention where you can get guidance. And what do you think Nkanyiso referred to? Not what he actually referred to, something that you can, platform you can use to get guidance. What was that?
Okay, no, I did not hear that. I will not lie.
Actually, I actually have answers already.
Yeah, because I feel like it's the CIOB network. Apparently, you guys do give mentors. But I'm just like, is it a different answer or what?
Yeah, it is a different answer. And it was mentors. So, Ntando, you were saying?
No, I was saying we already had answers on the chat box.
Oh.
Seeing the first one, if I'm not mistaken, it's mentors.
Yeah.
By September.
Yeah. And I think I'm going to close the questions on that. I don't know if you have any more gifts to give out, Jessica and Tando. Otherwise, we can keep going because these guys were listening.
Okay, just a quick one. Can anyone name the companies that our guest speakers are working for? They did introduce themselves. So whoever gets this one right wins our CIOB hamper. So when they started, they introduced themselves. If you can guess one, either their roles, specifically their roles, and two, if you can guess which companies they work for. Whoever gets this one first actually gets the prize. We still have hands up. Kumo.
Hi. So Nkanyiso works for.
Yes, hello.
Can you hear me? Hello.
Yeah, go for it.
Yes.
Okay. I don't know how to pronounce this word. I feel so weird that I don't know, but it's Abland. Abland or Abland. That's in Nkanyiso. That's the only place I remember.
Yes, correct. It's pronounced Abland.
Then you can't win.
But I've answered two questions correct. This is not fair.
It's good. It sparks the conversation. At least you guys were listening, you see?
There's a lot of hands up now.
There is a lot of hands up now. So that's perfect.
I feel like people are just Googling your name.
Yeah, I was about to say, everybody's doing quick search on Google.
Look, guys, it's great that you guys started chatting because you wanted to win the hamper. But I see a lot of people were throwing answers in the chat group. But the guys were raising their hands and wanted to talk, obviously trumps the chat group. So those guys kind of win. I know Ntando has been taking the questions and the answers. So he will let us know who has won or let you know if you've won and when you get the hamper.
That's a tough one because I asked for all our guest speakers and no one gave us all. The person that participated the most, everyone please help me.
I can give you all of them.
Woo! Okay. Go for it. Let's see what people gave you.
Yes. So for Kaiso, like Kumo already mentioned, and then Samuel works as a construction manager at Quartan Services. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right. For Tomorrow's Leaders, Champions, CIOB. And then CC is a project management professional at MCIOB. Tomorrow's Lead. Then Ronnie is the founder and CEO of the Construction Management Foundation for Tomorrow's Leader, CIOB.
You're reading the flyer, aren't you?
No, I wrote them down.
Ronnie's not in this meeting. He didn't even feature. He didn't even feature in the meeting. Nice try.
That was a good one.
You said we must be informed. I read everything. I knew where to get the information.
You're resourceful. We'll fix that.
That was a good one. Yes.
For your effort, let's be fair. Let's have number one and number two, or number one and then a runner. But
on the chat as well, we've got somebody who got two of the three. So that's also the most I've heard.
Okay. So it's OA2. It's Kumo, and it's Morepiwa. Okay, so what I'll do now, I'll just quickly write my email address. Please send me your details, your name, surname, university you're from, and a picture of yourself. And also send us your addresses where you'd like to have the prizes delivered to. We'll be giving you a very cool, I hope you're all students, but a very cool student starter pack. I won't mention what it is, but it's a very cool student starter pack. It's CLB branded. And I hope you are CLB registered students. And yeah, well done and all the best. So I'll just write my email as we're closing. So please make sure that you email me these details so that you can have your items couriered to you.